You know what? You know the reason why people quit, bro? Fucking what? He confirmed what I thought was right. See, there's two differences. There's one being broke and one being poor. See, broke is temporary. You know what? You know the reason why people quit, bro? Because they realize to get to the million-dollar dreams, bro, it's work. It's work. It's fucking work. I mean, you know what I don't get, Mansoor? Is that people are willing to work harder for a boss for 40 hours a week for somebody else at a W-2 than they're willing to work for themselves. Ain't that some shit? And they think that their million-dollar dreams are going to be paid at a $25 an hour work ethic. Someone says, man, I work my business hard. Great. Tell me the hours that you work in business. A guy took me out to lunch. He sends me an email. We've been connected on LinkedIn. I'd love to take you out to lunch and have a mutual value exchange of ideas. I learn from you, you learn from me. I already knew going to the lunch. I ain't learning from you. You know what I'm getting value from in the lunch? You buy me a burger. I wanted a burger that day, bro. I ain't learning nothing from you. Here's why. By the way, this is no ego. The reason why I'm not learning from you is, number one, I make more money than you. Number two, you reached out to me. Number three, I have 10 times the agents you have. I'm not learning anything from you, really. So that was my ego talking. What was the reality? I actually learned something from him. Why? What did I talk about Ray Dalio in the book Principles?
Always keeping up with
mind. Always keeping up with mind and assume that I'm what?
You could be wrong.
I could be wrong. He confirmed what I thought was right. Is even me, bro. I doubt myself.
He confirmed what you thought was right.
He confirmed what I thought was wrong was actually right. Because guys, in any conversation, the one that with the most confidence based on facts going into the conversation will win. So what do you tell me during a conversation? Yo, Matt, I got agents. Nobody works for me part-time. Boom, I already know I got you. Why? It's been proven since 1977 that the one that builds a sales force with not only full-time but part-time people will win. It's been proven since 1977.
1977. Is that when the baby, when the building game was?
With A.O. Williams. He started in his 30s because he was a high school football coach in Macon, Georgia. Yeah. By the way, Google real quick for me. What's the population today of Macon, Georgia? Okay, so 154K total. He became a billionaire, bro, out of Macon, Georgia. And we got 5 million people in the Chicagoland area. And technology, and social media, and YouTube. He didn't have that back then. Matter of fact, he wasn't even running weekly BLMs back then.
But what's the state of the economy? Same as today. I think the need for the dream and the opportunity is much more in demand today than it was back then.
Bro, I read his books from 1977. I read his message from the 80s. I read his books from the 90s. It's the same shit. It's the same stuff from the 70s, 80s. I've been doing this now officially for 20 years. I've been studying business since October 1998. You know, I know what I have in my office. I have my notebook from October 1998. Take a note. I still have it today. Like, you guys got your notes? I still have those notes 20 years later. I'm off. You know why? Because I know I was onto something. I knew I was onto something that can solve not only my initial problem, which is making a living, but I knew I was onto something that can save the bigger, deep down thought that I had is, man, I can really build something for my generation. Like, initially, I just need to pay the bills. But the more you get into this thing, dude, this thing can like impact my kids' kids. Like, because of YouTube, think about this, Mansoor. I do a video today, and I decide to stick with the business. I stay consistent. You realize right now, I can impact my kids in 2050. So what's 30 years from now? 30 years from now, I'm 75. How Gabs, how old will you be 30 years from now?
50.
Son of a... you see my point? Like, is YouTube gonna ever delete YouTube? Probably not. Like, the shit I say on YouTube, that's my time capsule. You know what a time capsule is? My time capsule is my YouTube video. You know the crazy part is, like, when I'm talking on this video, you know what I realize I'm impacting? I'm impacting my great-great-grandkids in 2080. Holy shit. You know what they're gonna say, bro? My great-great-granddad looks like just like me. I look just like him. I sound just like him. The people he's around looks just like my friends. They're just as broke as I was. Think of that, just raise the hairs on my arm. Like, I don't know my great-great-grandfather's name. I don't know him. I know his name. Sergio. Sergio Camacho Sapaula. That's my grandfather's name. And I knew that my family's last name was a slave name in the Philippines. Our families were, like, the Filipinos were slaves of the Spanish for close to 500 years. Longer than the African-American slave trade, transatlantic slave trade. Filipinos were enslaved. People don't know that. It's not talked about. So my last name is Sapaula. It's a slave field hand's name. Do you know what a wealthy Filipino's last name sounds like? Sanchez. Gonzalez. Because the Spanish married that family into their home. So if I have a Spanish last name, I was rich. But I'm a slave name, man. Today, if I'm gonna put $100 on it, $1,000, I don't know my grandmother's name on my dad's side. She died during World War II. They never told us how she died.
I just found myself like really just dating out because I want you to share with us, right? Like when you hit that million point bet shop, you know, where were you mentally to say, hey, let's do it again? And then when you did, you know, 2 million point bet shop, because I've already been telling people, hey, nobody's done what my mentor has done in the industry. You know, what is something that you can share with us, especially little old me, you know, being brand new in the industry, brand new to the business, to, you know, I know that I'm going to make millions in this industry. It's just about me putting my mind there mentally and being that. And so what is something you can say to us that helps keep that momentum, keep that focus?
I don't think any great change happened or any shift in activity happened until you're 100% absolutely sick and tired of your current situation. See, there's two differences. There's one being broke and one being poor. See, broke is temporary. Man, I just spent all my money. Man, I'm freaking broke, dude. I ain't got no money. Paycheck to paycheck. Boom, I'm broke. Or, dang, I just had to take all my money from my emergency savings to fix all my tires because stupid-ass construction in Chicago flattened my tires. Or, I remember when I had a house. Freaking raccoon pried open a space to get into my attic, and they shit all over my attic. And I had to spend $5,000 on fixing my roof, plugging up that hole, and replacing all that insulation so to get rid of freaking raccoon piss and shit. I'm freaking broke. Temporary situation. The problem with being, you know that old saying, what goes up must come down? But here's a challenge with that. What goes down doesn't automatically mean goes up.
Okay.
What comes down always has the probability that it, what goes up always has a probability that it's gonna come down one day. In a corporate life cycle, you get your survivability phase, your explosion phase, rapid growth phase, plateau, slow decline, rebirth. That's the progression of a company. So what it means is that what goes up eventually plateaus and comes down. And the people at this point of the company said, you know what, let's shift this thing. So for example, I remember growing up and Dunkin' Donuts was it, what type of company? What was Dunkin' Donuts growing up? What type of company was it? What did it sell the most?
Donuts.
Today, what is Dunkin' Donuts?
Coffee.
Exactly. So it was when this plateaued, slow decline, they decided to rebirth it, and that becomes a coffee company. And they're smart because they partnered with Baskin Robbins. You see? Mm-hmm. They're smart because they said, you know what? It's not profitable for our business model in today's financial climate to own our own building. It's smart for us to combine with another brand like Baskin Robbins, like Dunkin' Donuts. Because you see, being broke is temporary. Now, the flip side to that is poor is a state of mind. Poor can last for generations. Poor can last a year, 5 years, 10 years. And guess what happens when you're poor? You see that language into your kids.
That's the fear.
And they start talking poor. Words like, I'll try. Oh, you know, the teacher. Oh, you know, my classmates. To answer your question, when she and I first started the business, we were broke as a freaking joke. Girlfriend, I was at a freaking pawn shop in January 2015. When I first started the business, I was at a pawn shop. Sold whatever or what I can sell. I remember I sold a couple of my watches. I had a Bertolucci watch and I had a Movado watch. $5,000 of watches. I got $600 for it. You know, pawn shops love you. Talk about buy low, sell high. That's a pawn shop. What are they taking advantage of? They're taking advantage of my desperation.
They know you need to get rid of it.
They knew I needed to get rid of it. And on top of that, they knew the other offers were on the table. Otherwise, I wouldn't be at a pawn shop. So, I mean, to answer your question, that first year in 2015, we were absolutely freaking broke. I remember sitting in my home office. I peek out through the hallway, through the living room, seeing Sheena on the couch crying, bawling in a pillow. She's crying, bawling in a pillow. I said, you know what? She's crying, bawling because her freaking flat ass broke. And I remember telling myself, you know what? I could say it's gonna be okay. It'll be all right. Well, I better make it all right. So what I do? Get on the phone. Make calls. That's when Patrick called me back. PBD. Patrick, nice to meet you. I was introduced to you by a pastor 5 years ago, 6 years ago. I know we've never really talked, but tell me more about PHP. He tells me about PHP. Follows up with me on Monday, Tuesday. This is when George Palaya was an SVP. I remember him, me introducing him to, I looked at him through FaceTime, you know, young guy, tie on. You know, I remember telling myself, wow, young company. That's your SVP? That's the top of the company?
Yeah.
Awesome. A young company. I love it.